Frozen 2 is the much-awaited sequel to the much-beloved film starring that song you probably haven't gotten out of your head by now. In this film, Arendelle is in trouble. Elsa hears a mysterious voice calling out to her, and therefore goes missing as she attempts to discover her past and how she got her magic ice powers. Somehow I missed this one when it came out in theaters, but I'm sure you haven't, considering the box office results. There were several cases where I had the opportunity to go, but something would come up at the last minute and would lose my chance to. Now with that nasty COVID-19, Disney Plus has decided to release it on the platform 3 months early, since movie theaters appear to be closing, and any big new release is being pushed back anywhere from 6 months to a year. So of course, in this unfortunate time, everyone will turn to different streaming services out there, such as Disney Plus, Netflix, or Hulu. Anyways, with all that being said, I finally got to see Frozen 2 to see if it lived up to all the hype. Now before I begin, I want you to know that I really have nothing against the first film. I thought it was fine, just found it a little overrated when other movies such as Tangled or even Moana, I have found myself liking more, and yet those two don't get nearly as much love as Frozen. Then the annoyingly long Olaf's Frozen Adventure, you know, that 20-minute not-so-short film that played before Pixar's Coco, which, believe it or not, is my all-time favorite animated film. So you can see where I'm coming from when I say that Olaf's Frozen Adventure needs to be wiped off from the face of the planet. They also felt the need to slap this brand on anything they can get their mingy little hands on as quickly and as affordably as possible. You see, I'm a major Disney and theme parks fan, going to Disney World my whole life on a regular basis. So the fact that they basically repurposed an old 30-some-odd-year-old ride to a Frozen-themed ride was a bit overkill for me, and when I really lost all faith in the property. Well, I'm out of breath from that little rant. Just needed to get all that off my chest. This movie is quite gorgeous to look at, though. I'll give it that. The animation is top-notch, to say the least. You can zoom in on any piece of clothes, landscape, anything, and see incredible details put into it. Something Disney seems to be doing more and more to replicate Pixar's animation style, and I love it. Now, some may find this really annoying, but Olaf got some very good laughs from me. At first, I found him really annoying, actually, but after a while, I got used to him and warmed up to him and his ridiculous ways, and he grew on me. My favorite scenes by far were when he literally was mimicking the first film, like that scene where he reenacts the entire movie to the new guys that they just met. That was pretty funny. All that being said, I found the actual plot of the movie not that interesting. Sure, it's the kind of plot that may sound good on paper, but wasn't executed that well. I found myself checking out more times than not every once in a while, because it didn't just captivate me all too much. I was just like, okay, where were these guys that they're just meeting now in the first movie? If they were in the forest, shouldn't they have passed their village when going to find Elsa then? They also just seemed like a plot device because the filmmakers didn't know what to do. I don't know. The whole idea of the dam that, if broken, would destroy Arendelle also seemed a bit odd. Then the whole past being revealed through ice sculptures didn't work for me either. The giant rock monsters also seemed a bit far-fetched, and what was the deal with Kristoff? I could write a whole essay about why Kristoff had no motive and should not have been in this film, because he really just weighted down how they could have made his character a whole lot better, blah blah blah. His entire arc was trying to propose to Anna, and it just got annoying after a while. Then he kind of just disappears for a while because the plot has no room for him at that point. That's how I look at it. The movie didn't know what to do with him, So he sings a happy little song about he wants to find love and propose to Anna, and then he just kind of goes off and comes back for his final scene at the very end, and that's it. That is his entire role in this movie. His entire role. Okay, with all these complaints and rants and problems I have with it, you're probably thinking, wow, this guy really doesn't like this movie. But that's not really the case. I don't find many other flaws with it, other than those like 3 or 4, maybe 5 or 6 nitpicks that I just couldn't get past. But I didn't really despise the movie. I thought it was fine. Not Disney's best by any means. I don't think it really lived up to the hype. But the plot was only about halfway through to being excellent when it had so much potential. The comedy was on point most of the time. However, if you're someone who can't stand the happy snowman, then you might find yourself sitting there annoyed through the entire duration of the movie. Because boy does Olaf get a lot of screen time. The songs for the most part were great too. There were a few that felt unnecessary. I mean, in the first 15 minutes there was already like 5 or 6 songs. And I was like, oh, here we go. Whenever a new song would play. As far as the performances too, they were all good as well. As expected. The movie was fun. I think it's a great way to pass the time to get through this nasty virus. If you already have Disney Plus, which I'm sure a lot of you do, then why not give it a watch? And if you're an adult with kids, put it on for them. I guarantee it'll keep them out of your hair for a couple hours. In conclusion, I'll have to give this movie a 7 out of 10. Not as bad as I expected, but could have been better for sure. Thank you all for watching, stay safe out there, and I'll see you in the next one. That's a wrap.